communicates with him. Mostly, it's God who communicates back to the Christian. It can be directly speaking to him. For example, in Mount Sinai, when Moses went to meet the Lord, he came in the form of a cloud and he spoke to Moses as he speaks to a man. A man speaks to a man. He was in the presence of the Lord. He came down from heaven. In the case of Jacob, he saw heaven open, a ladder, and he saw the Lord up. But between him and the Lord were what? Angels communicating with him. In the form of, when we come to Daniel, Daniel saw the Lord, but he spoke to an angel, Gabriel. Angel, is it Michael? Not Gabriel. In the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was being baptized, the heavens was torn open. And who spoke to him? God the Father himself. And the Holy Ghost came down in the form of a dove. So an open heaven is that state where a Christian gains a direct access with the Lord. And the Lord himself comes down to the Christian, and the Christian can communicate back to God without any hindrances. When does he feel? And the best for us on earth is that we should always live in that state. If we could achieve that, that would be the best. The Lord Jesus Christ was there. In any case, he was God himself. But for us, some of us need to do much more to achieve that state of an open heaven. Now, when we're talking about an open heaven, does it mean there is a closed heaven? Oh, yes. If you have an open heaven, you can also have a closed heaven. I'm sure all of you here pray. Have you ever gone to a place you pray? Oh Lord, it's like prayer yako hata ipiti mdomo. Achana na siri. Unaomba God, God, unaanza kukumbuka kidheri ya jana. Oh Lord, you are busy dreaming of other things. You are trying to pray, but you are full of what? Other things are full in your head. Have you ever reached there? Have you ever gone to a mission whereby you are going to pray, even the prayer itself getting out is a struggle, until you wonder whether you know how to pray? Have you gone to a certain house, ukiingia tu hivi, you feel darkness surrounding you? Praise the Lord. So if the heavens can be open, it means heavens can also be closed. A very good example is the same Daniel we have read. In Daniel chapter 10, the one we have just read, the angel came and told him that right from the day you started praying, your prayers were heard and you started answering. So I was coming with the message, the answer, that for 21 days, I was restrained by who? By the prince of Persia. In other words, the heavens to Daniel were trying to be blocked by who? The prince of darkness, the prince of Persia, is the one who was trying to block Daniel's heavens, that he couldn't access direct to the throne of God. So to break through, two things happen. If you read that scripture, you'll find there is 21:21. Daniel fasted and prayed for how many days? 3 weeks. 3 weeks is how many days? 21. And what did the angel say? How many days was he restrained? 21. Some of you ask, why is that fasting 40 days? Fasting 21, even Dr. Wap. We are just trying to follow what David did, what Daniel did. Daniel fasted and prayed for how many days? 21. Interestingly, the 21 equaled. You can cancel the 21 ya kushikiliwa. So he achieved his breakthrough on the last day. And the angel took another 3 days to arrive, because it's on the 24th day that the angel arrived. I'm saying, oh Daniel, immediately you started praying. We answered it. But as on my way coming, prince of Persia, the kingdom of Persia, help me. Bwana sikiwe. So, if we have understood that a heaven can be open and a heaven can be closed, it is very good for all of us to walk with an open heaven. There is a writer who likes coming to my house in Eldoret. You know him, Steve Ogan. He's a Nigerian writer. So every time he used to come to my house, we have a guest house. He would always say, that's my house. So one day I said, what's the problem? He said, you know what? I have an open heaven here. Anytime I sleep in this room, oh my, I get revelations, I write books. And for sure, every time he used to come there, he will write a new book with a new revelation. Well, as if he will. There are also homes you will enter. So, how do we then bring these open heavens to us? If we forget, let me give the summary of everything else. When we commit ourselves to seeking the Lord, God, on a regular basis through persevering prayers. I'm using the word persevering. Is prayer easy? It's not easy. Persevering prayers, diligent, obedient, and sacrificial giving, we will start experiencing an open heaven from God. That's what I can summarize all this. But there are some of the principles that fit into this from the scriptures we have read. Number one, for you to be or to experience an open heaven, you must be holy. What do scriptures say? The Lord said, be holy because I am holy. Without holiness, you will not see the Lord. But we are asking to see the Lord. But what's the Lord saying? Be holy, and without holiness, you cannot see Him. And that's simple to tell you that if you are not holy, you cannot experience an open heaven. So the first principle is that you must be holy, because the Lord says, be holy because I am holy. Without holiness, you will not see God. The second one, consecrate yourself. In any case, how do you become holy? You should continuously consecrate yourself. Now, the question of how do you consecrate yourself? Let's go back to some of these scriptures. Just to understand how they did it in the Old Testament. If you go back to Genesis, to Exodus, not Genesis. If you go to Exodus chapter 19, verse 10, it says this. That's the time Moses was preparing the Israelites to go and meet with God in Mount Sinai. In Exodus 19, verse 10 says this. And the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day, because on that day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. It goes down and says, put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you do not go up the mountain or touch the foot of the mountain. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. If you try to reach the Lord and touch the Lord and you are not holy, not well consecrated, what are the consequences? Death. And the Old Testament has so many examples. You remember when the Ark of the Lord was being transported and it was carried by some bulls. And when it was threatening to fall down, what happened to some fellow? He rushed and tried to support him. In the process, he was struck dead. Even David got scared. Akasema kama mwenye aliguza amekufa na sasa hiki kitu nataka ende kwangu. So what did he say? He diverted it. But what's the name of that guy? Obed-edom. So Obed-edom said, me, I'm talking Mungu kwako, leta kwako. And Obed-edom was really blessed because of the presence of the Lord. So, there are so many examples even in the Old Testament. You cannot go to the Lord when you are not holy and touch His presence, because if you dare do that, you'll be struck dead. That's only an example where the Lord said, consecrate yourselves. The other one is, how else do you consecrate yourself? One of them is repentance. There are so many things you need to do, but one of them is repentance. You know, when we do the sinner's prayer and we repent and we get born again, it is true, we are now children of God. That is saying, with your heart you believe, with your mouth you confess, and so you are saved. Praise the Lord, that's good. But who was, in the book of 1 John, who was, is it Peter who wrote that? In the letter of 1 John, who was he referring to? Let's read that. 1 John chapter 1, verses 8. First John chapter 1, verses 8 to 10. It says this. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make Him out to be a liar, and His word is not in us. What does it feel? We are born again, yes. Are we going to heaven? Yes. Do we sin? Yes. What is the word saying? If we claim to be without sin, then we are liars. So, but we have been given a solution to it. What is it says? Repent. Well, confess your sin. It even says confess to one another. God has healed. When we confess our sins and ask for forgiveness, the Lord cleanses us from all that and we shall remain righteous before God. That is part of the consecration you need to do so that you can be in the presence of the Lord. God has healed. And we need to do it frequently. Now, during this holiday, as I said, I mentioned some bypassing that I went with my family down to Costa. I was given a book by one of the missionaries. And that book was talking about the deceit of Satan, the bait of Satan. And this bait is unforgiveness. I don't know how many of us ever know that there is a big sin on not forgiving people. We read this verse every day, but we ignore it. If we go to the book of Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 6, I think we're almost concluding. Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 and 15. Matthew chapter 6, 14 and 15. It says this, "For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins." How many of us have taken you seriously? Unakuja kuhubiri kanisani, lakini mtu wa moto baika hapa ameingia mbele yako. Umemuita majina. Unasema wacha nikitoka chaji ndio na wewe. Na utakuja kanisa, you are not listening to the preacher. You are busy calculating how to go and deal with this character. But have you read that scripture? What is it saying? If you do not forgive men their sins when they sin against you, your Father in heaven will not forgive you. In that book I was reading, they gave a story of somebody who died and went to heaven. And when he was there, he was shown his mother-in-law. A lady he knew was a dear daughter of the Lord. She was those wazee mnajua amezama ndani ya Kristo. But then he was told, "Now your mother-in-law ndio huyo anaelekea wapi?" Akauliza, "Lord, why?" Then he was told, "She never forgave your father-in-law." Then the picture came back to her. And she remembered how this father-in-law used to torture this lady. He was running around with other women, he neglected the lady. Your dad took in our ugly way, the guy had done too much bad things to the lady. But until the guy died, the lady also never forgave. So the lady, the Lord told her, look, it's very simple. Forgive, and then forgive you. You don't forgive, your sins are not forgiven. And if your sins are not forgiven, you are what? You remain a sinner. And sinners, hell was made for who? The devil and those who sin. For eternity you spend where? Sasa hii miaka yote ume praise the Lord, ume chezea Bwana, ume give. But the only sin you have is unforgiveness. That touched me. And I went into scripture. Then it surprised me that there's so much literature in the scripture that talks about unforgiveness. I'll give a personal testimony. There's a fellow colleague doctor. We really respect him. He's a very senior doctor in Eldoret. And he does a superb job. So, because we respect him, he came to me when I was very busy in the clinic and told me, Doctor, I'm in trouble. My land is going. I just need some good millions. And he came with papers. How fast he needs money for just 2 weeks. I told him, hey, I'm not such a millionaire. I don't have those millions. Just give me what you have. I said, okay. You asked me for 3 million, but I can give you 1 million now. Like, please, that will help. I'll get from another person and another. So, I called my wife. You know me and how we are one.
Yes.
I don't know how you handle your finances. So I called her and said, Doctor is in front of me. Please come quickly and we help him. So she came quickly. I said, go with Doctor, go and I don't know where you get the 1 million. Go and get him. All our accounts give him 1 million. Wife drove with the doctor in his car, went to the bank, withdrew cash, and gave the doctor 1 million. The 2 weeks, sure, hey, doctor, what is happening? Story. 1 month, 2 months, 6 months, 1 year. And then we discovered it was not only me. He had done the same to about 10 doctors. So, have you ever been tempted to kill somebody? No, brethren, let's be sincere with ourselves. You know, we can chat and then you become too spiritual. Let's be very sincere. You know, I remember I've been urged by many people to own a gun. This is the time if I had a gun. I'll just walk to the office and say, unatoa mautoni. Sema sichoi, nasema haya kufa nai. I mean, there was so much bitterness in my heart. Because I couldn't understand. Especially when we discovered that he had called many other doctors. I tried talking to the police, they told me, ah, that guy has too many problems. Hi! So, meet a man, you end up people. So, but somehow, because I became the ringleader of the other doctors, I formed a WhatsApp group. Let's deal with this guy. So, I think the guy got wind. Sorry. The day got wind that we might do something to him. So quickly, we got another old doctor, we call him Kuka, an elder, to go and try and they sit in the same office to consign them. In the process, the guy realized, let me silence them a bit. He gave him a check of 500,000 to bring to me. To me, that's a blessing. At least half of it in a kuja. I think I eat a mama and I go and the only person I could reach. But another 1 year was disappearing. So in December, when I was reading this book, you know, I started searching myself. And I asked God, is there anybody I have not forgiven? Because this seems to be a very serious thing. that I can miss heaven just because I'm not forgiven somebody. And it's the first thing that showed in me. I said, but Lord, am I not forgiven? He said, yeah, sure. Because in that group, we even decided we are going to hire thugs. Not to kill him, but that to catch him and give him a thorough beating. We had gone that far. Because we couldn't understand how a guy is enjoying what we have sweated for. So, when we were in Mombasa, I remembered, I said, please God, first of all, I don't need that money. I'm alive, I'm okay, everything is going on well with me. But that half a million now remaining cannot make me miss where? And I said, please Lord, forgive that guy. Forgive me. I forgive him, whether he brings or he doesn't bring, he knows it. I leave it alone. Now, fast track it this month, last week actually, in fact on Thursday. Then, my car, I was driving a car that was big and had issues. So it starts bringing problems. And I kept talking to my wife, she didn't like it. Who's a Inca Prado? And I was like, me and my son were like, how do we sell this car? It was sentimental attachment. But then we started praying, Lord, bring a buyer. Somebody else who, then on Wednesday, not Wednesday, on Wednesday or Tuesday, a buyer shows up when I was in the clinic very late. At 4, it was 4. He came at 4 and then he said, I want to buy your car. I said, hey, this car has problems. Problem number one in here, number two, number three, you here. Do you really want it? Why can he end the night? So he went and drove it, tested, then he came back. He said, how much do you want? So I told him what I want. And then he introduced himself as a bishop. I said, bishop, you know you can buy something that will bless you, you can also buy something that will bring you. Yes. I was that honest, so I told him. So this car, if you really want it, I've told you the problems. Do you want to buy it with the problems? I said, yes, yes, I want it. I said, no problem. But there's one problem I must solve before you take the car. He said, which one? I said, these locks, they've just jammed in the morning. And I've called the mechanic. He said, forget about it. You are not going, I'm not giving you this key. I said, what do you mean? He went. Late at night, he said, I'm not giving you the key. If you don't trust me, I'm leaving you a check now. I said, what do you mean? He said, I mean, guy in the army. So I called my wife. She was like, in Kakamega here and said, you know what has happened? I have no car. So the bishop gave me his car plus his driver. Take me to Hosip